So let's look at electrophoretic light scattering. If we shine a laser beam through a sample of particles, each particle will scatter the light and create a Doppler shift dependent on the velocity of that particle. It's like a police radar speed trap. And if you have millions of particles, then you have millions of Doppler shifts all contributing to the intensity of the scattered light. This varies with time in a similar way to a sound signal. You can use a spectrum analyzer to see the frequency components of the sound, and you can do the same thing to see a spectrum or distribution of the Doppler shift frequencies of the scattered light. If you know the geometry of the equipment, you can convert the frequency distribution to a velocity distribution. If you know the electric field, you can get an electrophoretic mobility distribution and then calculate a zeta potential distribution. This has been available since the 1970s, and here we see a zeta potential distribution. Another method is phase analysis light scattering, PALS, that I invented in the late 1980s. It uses a different way of processing the same signal. Why would you want to do this? Well, the laser Doppler method has a limitation as far as how much electrolyte you can have present in your sample. As you increase the electrolyte concentration, you start to see adverse effects like heating or bubble formation at the surfaces of the electrodes and other unwanted behavior that makes the measurement impossible using the laser Doppler method. Phase analysis gets around some of the limitations, but sacrifices the ability to show you the distribution. Instead, you get a single average value. Above 10 millimolar ionic strength, commercial instruments switched to using PALS, simply because they cannot do the laser Doppler measurements. But PALS measurements are only valid if the sample is truly monomodal with respect to zeta potential. You have to assess whether that's an appropriate assumption or not for your particular purpose. I've developed a next generation electrophoretic light scattering system that does allow you to get the zeta potential distribution at these higher electrolyte concentrations. But there's another problem that arises with using high salt concentrations, and it also relates to the electrodes. When you put the voltage across the electrodes, each electrode assumes a charge. On the left, we've got a positively charged electrode surface, and it looks just like the surface of a positively charged particle. There's a double layer, and there's adsorbed material. If you look at the electrical potential curve, you see the same drop across that bound region. The potential within the sample is less than you're assuming it to be just based on the distance between the electrodes and the voltage. Even though there are different ways of generating the electric field with different instruments, they don't account for this drop in the electric field. So calculated zeta potentials are underestimated. So we have underestimation of zeta potential due to electrode polarization, and underestimation due to the wrong choice of model to do the calculation. That's two assumptions that lower the calculated zeta potential. My new instrument can determine what the true electric field is and make a more faithful measurement that will increase your confidence. I've collaborated with the University of Sheffield to compare my next generation system with a leading commercial instrument. We studied electrostatically stabilized latex particles in potassium chloride solutions ranging from 0.5 millimolar to 4 molar. The blue data are from my instrument, and the red data are from the commercial instrument. Not surprisingly, the instruments agree up to 10 millimolar. But beyond that, the commercial instrument reports a lower zeta potential than my instrument, which accounts for the reduction in the electric field.